is going to wrap up the string on catastrophic environmental matters. One quick announcement before we start. Could you please belong, please? If they're yours, they're at the front of the room. Over to you.
All right, so I'm going to talk about the sort of compositional and behavioral properties of entangled states. So as anybody who's messed with it knows, the sort of task of talking about entanglement greater than two parties really is kind of a monumental thing. Like it quickly turns into a mess, this idea of coming up with these kind of exhaustive classification themes for multipartite states. So we're trying to take a slightly different tact at it and say, what sorts of algebraic properties do states have, and what sorts of behavioral properties do they have, and how can we exploit these to actually do stuff with them? So let's see. But before I get started, you guys are probably quite familiar with this by now, but the bit of notation, well, I write my diagrams this way, so there's no confusion. So I'm going to write a state as something like this. So this is a map out of the complex numbers into, and for this talk I'm really only going to talk about qubits. So this is a map into C2. And also we can write an effect like this. So this is a map from C2 to C1. So I'm guessing everybody's good with this by now. I suppose just holler if anything is confusing. Okay, so one of the things we start to do to start trying to characterize states is talk about the things that we don't care about when we're talking about entangled states. So one of the things we want to sort of quotient over are the things you can do locally. We want to view an entangled state as a sort of non-local resource. So one of the things we can say is that a state called Big Psi is convertible into another state called Big Phi by, this is called LOCC, which means local operations. A state psi is hard step here. So we'll talk about the maximal slog states. And the nice thing is in qubits, well, at least low numbers of qubits, there aren't very many of them. So, for instance, this is, again, it's hard to call this a theorem, but there's exactly one genuine maximal slog state in two parties. So this is pretty easy to see. The maximal one is just the one that's locked with the Bell state. And anything else that has less entanglement, it just pretty much drops out of the Bell state. And then in three parties, there are exactly two maximal slog states. So, and these are sort of incomparable. One doesn't convert to the other. So, one of the states, which you've already heard about some, is the GHZ state. There's another one, which is called the W state. And that's all you get. This is a result due to Durr-Vidal, Seurat, 2000.
So these two cannot be converted.
Right, yeah. So, in some sense, these are two kind of disjoint tops on this slot ordering. And then any other state you can get to from one of these sort of doing slot operation. So, everyone good with that so far? Okay, so we want to start talking a bit more abstractly about this. Yeah?
One question. So, you can get to any state from both of them. There are states which you can get to from both of them, states that you can get to from one and the other, right?
You can get to any state from one or the other.
From one or the other.
Yeah.
So, but then the whole space will be separated into two subspaces, right? One is obtainable from GZ, and from W.
It doesn't necessarily have to be disjoint. So, for instance, there could be a protocol where you start with GHZ, and then you destroy all your entanglement and end up in a product state down here. Or you could have started from W and destroyed all your entanglement and ended up in a product state. But there's sort of no protocol there, I think is the main point. So we want to start looking at the properties of these kind of maximally entangled states. And one fairly slick way to say something is maximally entangled, we'll look at very familiar if you've been paying attention to these category talks for the last week, is that if we have a bipartite state like this, and there exists a bipartite effect, like so, such that this equals identity, then this state is maximal. So, in particular, you can see that a product state definitely wouldn't have this property. So, if we had a product state, and we tried to do this, then this is just some other effect. And that's not going to be the identity. So, in qubits, this is kind of all you have. Product states, or you have states with this property. But in higher dimensions, you can have more. So, in a sense, this is a strictly stronger property than there being any entanglement. And then we can also kind of try to push this up into more parties. So, one of the ways you can say a tripartite state is maximum entanglement is there exists some effects, you know, just call them 1, 2, and 3. Such that this state, with 1 here, this state, with 2 here, and this state, 3 here, are all maximally entangled bipartite states. So does that make sense? Does everyone kind of get an intuition of why this is so? In a sense, if there was any degeneracy inside of this state, then you would be able to see it witnessed by one of these three. But also, we're going to kind of restrict our view now and kind of keep the GZ state and the W state in mind. And one of the things that will immediately jump out at you is they're both symmetric states. So let's focus on symmetric states. So you can make this property easier to say once you're symmetric, which is there exists some point like this, we'll call it little phi, such that we can do this. And there exists some effect. Psi prime, such that that equals the identity. So for a symmetric state, this is exactly how you can say that this state is maximally entangled. And as you can see, the thing that's kind of hiding here is the line-yanking theorem. So if you see the line kind of going like this, and then you yank it straight, and then you have the identity, like so. So that's, we've already captured kind of two properties in saying that this is symmetric, saying it's maximally entangled. But there's another thing that these have that's kind of special in that they're really symmetric. And I'll try to make that a bit more rigorous. I'm sure you don't want to accept just really symmetric as a definition. They both have in-party versions. So, and any introductory human book shown the in-party GHC state. My ends look a lot like W's here, don't they? Okay. So there's also kind of a natural in-party W state, which is just where I go 1 and a lot of zeros. I go 0, 1, and a lot of zeros. All the way up to low zeros. So everyone sees how this is kind of the natural extension of these up. Yang theorem. And we have the property that, is this getting too small for people back there? This thing is symmetric. So this is actually suffices to get this property, that you get the mean cubic version, and it is also symmetric. So if we take a step back and look at what we've actually defined here, unless you saw this coming, it might be a bit of a surprise. This is exactly the same data as a commutative Frobenius algebra. So, if all week you don't really know what people have been on about Frobenius algebras, one way you can think about them is as really symmetric states. So, and there's a way of going back and forth between these things, which I'll sort of sketch out in how much time I have. So, the normal definition we have, for a commutative Frobenius algebra is we have a commutative monolabel, which is a multiplication map. Any unit where this multiplication is associative, meaning this. So you should have seen most of this the other day. And this X is a unit for the multiplication on the left and the right. It's got a commutative comonomy, which is just all this other stuff upside down. And these two things cohere with each other in a very nice way, in that they satisfy this Frobenius identity, where a multiplication is allowed to be factored sort of past a multiplication, commuted past a multiplication. So we're all happy with this definition. So why is this the same thing as a really symmetric state? Well, a commutative Frobenius algebra already comes with a really symmetric state inside of it. So if I do a unit, and this is a unit for my multiplication, and then I do a comultiplication, co-multiplication, I get a map from C to three copies of C2, which we can think of as some sort of state. some cycles in it, maybe got some bigger cycles. Then I can say, and to really make specific what I mean by holes, it's kind of the number of edges I could take away and not disconnect the thing. So I count two here. Then I have a normal form where I put two holes in the middle. And I count my inputs, or my outputs, 1, 2, 3, 4. I go 1, 2, 3, 4. And count my inputs, 1, 2, 3. And these are equal. So, yeah.
One is contended, yeah, right?
What did you say?
Is this by definition?
This is a theorem of Frobenius algebras. So these identities, the fact that this is a commutative monomial, co-commutative co-monomial, and the Frobenius identity is actually enough to derive this for any such diagrams. So in some sense, I call this the normal form because it really makes explicit how many holes you have and your inputs and your outputs. So it's kind of obvious to know how to get to this. So this kind of begs the question of what happens to these holes, and we have some choices of what we can do. We can say we don't know anything about what happens with these holes, but more interestingly, we can say one of two things about holes, and you've already seen one of the things we can say, and that's that they don't matter. So this is the big representation theory for SCFAs and qubits theorem. Let's see. The other sort of symmetric theorem we have, or analogous theorem we have, is, and you can probably see what's coming. Any ACFA has a state, same kind of state like this, which is Slot equivalent to W state. And any such W state arises as such a thing from an ACFA.
How different are the special unit for BDS algebras on C2? How different can they be? Are they all isomorphic to the
Yeah.
one?
So the
all dagger ones.
Every SCFA can be uniquely identified by the basis which it copies. So in some sense they are all isomorphic, and the thing that makes them isomorphic is a change of base. They're not all dagger, they're only dagger if they copy orthonormal bases. But I believe they are actually all dagger scalar or something like that.
And do the so when you talk about Slot equivalence of a state that's Slot equivalent to the GHZ state, does that just mean a little more general than a GHZ state in a different basis? Is that the same as saying a GHZ state in some basis?
That is essentially what it means. So to say I'm Slot equivalent with GHZ basically means that I've written a GHZ state in some basis, you know, So in some sense, realizing that this is an SCFA, if you're used to SCFAs being something that copies points, is not too surprising, because if I project this point, I'll get two copies of this point. If I project this point, I'll get two copies of this point. So the fact that these generate this kind of Frobeniusy type structure, I think, was the surprising thing. We have this representation theorem, but I mentioned at the start of this talk that we really wanted to start doing things with these states. So we'll see what we can do with them. First of all, since we have normal forms for both of these, it tends to suggest that treating them by themselves is not particularly interesting, and that it's either a spider or an exploding spider. So you don't really have a very rich structure to work with. But we can explore interaction properties if we take an SCFA in hand and an ACFA in hand and let them interact with each other. So we'll let this, with the empty dots, represent the sort of GHZ state SCFA. And we'll let this, with the filled in dots, be a W state ACFA. I always struggle with this in Blackboard talks because I'm used to saying that this is the white one and this is the black one, but it sort of messes you up. So we can even be a bit more general and say that there's a distinguished pair of states, which we call a GHZW pair, which interact with each other in a nice way. And we can identify four kind of interaction rules, which we can use to derive lots of stuff. So the first rule, and this is really where things start to move away from the red-green calculus already, is whereas in the red-green, the induced caps and cuts were equal,
W cup. It's the same as if I go the other way around. And we're actually going to use this particular composition so much that we make it a definition. And we just put a little tip on a line for when this happens. If you've seen some of the more detailed red green literature, this is what's called a dualizer. So it's something that sort of converts the two different compact structures back and forth between each other. But if you couldn't parse that last sentence, don't worry about it too much. Okay, so the other identity we have is up to some scaling factor, which I'll just draw as a little circle. So, in a sense, you just think of this as maybe a little W thing like this. So, up to some scaling factor, the tick actually converts units which are these nice, friendly things with respect to the anti-special Fermi's algebra into loops, which are these catastrophic things. So, in some sense, this thing acts like a switch that's going to be alternating between this sort of identity type behavior and this topology breaking behavior. And in some sense, it's a bit like a knock gate, which we'll see that in a moment. I guess, is everyone all right if I run about 5 over since I started? So, is that okay? Okay, so let's see. The third identity is that the G of same dot copies the W of same dot. The fourth identity, and the fourth and final identity, is that the tick passes through. So if you're familiar with working with these SCFAs at all, then you know that they copy a basis. And you realize that this tick, just being a knot, actually just permutes this basis, which it copies. So it's able to pass through like this. It's an automorphism of the Frobenius algebra, to use slightly more sophisticated language, I guess. So we have these four fairly simple little properties. So we'd like to see what kinds of things they do. So if we think about having circuits and we have as inputs this thing and this thing, and if we unroll the definition, these are just ket 0 and ket 1. They might be ket 1 and ket 0, but everything's symmetric, so it doesn't matter too much. Then the SCFA acts a bit like a junction, in the sense that if I put in a black dot here, it gets copied because of this axiom. Or if I put in a tick dot, then this tick gets copied, and the whole tick dot gets copied. So the way to think about this is, in some sense, analogous to in the classic circuit picture of having one of these kinds of junction things, where if I put in a 0 here, the 0 is going to go down both of these lines. But of course, it's specific to some particular basis, because no clumping and that sort of stuff. Now, the W state, we can think of as another kind of classical circuit component, which is, it's the thing that if I put in this black dot, it just makes a wire. But if I put in the tick dot, then up to a scalar, this is turned into a loop. And as we know, loops are catastrophic. So it goes like this, and like this. You notice I've left out control wire is acting like a switch, but it will not get like this. This is acting like a switch. If I feed it 1, it's going to let this wire through. If I feed it 0, it's going to let this wire through. Now, if I take this exact diagram and I replace my tri-states with filled-in dots, I replace my NOT gate with our analog of a NOT gate. I replace my junction with our analog of a junction. And then the analogy breaks down a little bit. But essentially, you can show via rewriting that this is a this acts as a control bit. And if I put this in, it's going to create an identity down this channel. And it's going to make a projector on this channel. If I put a 1 in, it's going to make an identity down this channel, make a projector down this channel. So, in a sense, I can inductively build up bigger and bigger states. So if I call this thing a MUX, and I put a control here, and I dangle 2 states off of it like that, then this sort of acts as a control of this or this type gate. And this, coupled with our ability, you can actually generate arbitrary 1-qubit maps, actually makes the system computationally universal if you want to add single-qubit ones. And this stuff, it has a lot of nice properties. One of the things we're looking at now is actually you can build lots of interesting kind of matrix product states using these things. You can use these generators to actually describe primitives in preparations of bigger states. And just all sorts of stuff. So, and that's kind of, that's where I'll finish, I guess.
Here on what